61A, lecture number 8. Announcements. There is nothing due this week. Enjoy the break after the midterm. There are two completely optional contests. Due Monday if you want to participate. They are completely optional. You don't have to participate. There's a dice design contest. There's a hog strategy contest. If you're interested in the hog strategy contest, you might enjoy the extra lecture this Thursday, 9 a.m. in 20 Social Sciences Building, where I'll talk about two things related to hog strategy. One is how to compute an optimal strategy in a two-player game, and the other is how to compute probabilities using dice. If you put these two ideas together, you might just have a viable entry for the strategy contest. Take a look at the game rules. All the rules from the project and one extra one, which is that you can get an extra turn. If you roll k dice on turn n, and n mod 8 is equal to k. You can only get one extra turn in a row. And this one's tricky because your strategy is not a function of what turn it is. It's only a function of the player scores. So you'd have to guess what turn it is, or you could ignore this rule entirely. But taking it into consideration might actually give you a small advantage. Also, new this year is a size penalty, something we've never tried before. The size is the length of the program that you submit. Instead of having your goal score always be 100, it will be a function of the size of the final strategy.py file that you submit. Your target score will be your program size in bytes divided by 10,000 times 300. And what's this crazy thing? This says your goal score is always an integer. It can't be bigger than 300. It can't be smaller than 50. So if you have a really small program, you don't have to get as many points to win the game. Who knows? Maybe always roll 5 is the way to go. Again, if you just want to build a cool strategy and ignore this, it might work out. But you might have to get more points in order to win the game. So, I hope you have some fun with that. Remember that those are completely optional. One thing I would like you to do this week is take a look at how your midterm one was scored. Make sure that we got it right. Submit regrade requests by next Wednesday if you notice any place where we applied a rubric incorrectly. We're not going to change the rubric at this point, so if you feel like you should have gotten more partial credit than the rubric would assign, well, you won't. If you submitted an answer that is correct, you should get full credit for that, even if it wasn't the answer that we were expecting. And you might find some clerical errors. But more importantly, you might have a chance to review the questions that you got wrong, and you might learn something about how to solve similar questions in the future. Overall, the class did very well, but I'm sure there are some students out there who didn't get the score they wanted. I know that that can be very stressful and disheartening, but I encourage you not to give up. Midterm 1 is worth less than midterm 2 or the final. Most of the points in this course have yet to come. Your grade is not determined at all. You have an indication of whether you need to practice more or whether things are going pretty well. If it turns out you need to practice more, that's how you improve in this course. And one great way to spend an extra hour a week practicing is to join a CS Mentoring section. CS Mentors is a student group that organizes small group mentoring sections where you go over course concepts in order to prepare yourself for doing well on exams and mastering the course material. These aren't there to help you solve the homework and the projects. They're there to help you get good at answering questions on your own, which is a very important skill. So you should be working on it anyway. Why not do it in a small group with a mentor? The people who lead these mentoring sections are often members of the course staff, though not always, but they're all people who are excited about helping you learn. So click here for a Piazza post with all the details about how to join. And if it turns out you'd like to join, but you can't find a slot that works for you, you should follow up on that post and let the organizers know. Who knows? Maybe they'll create more capacity or find some way to squeeze you in. Okay, so today we'll start a new topic in the course called recursion. But the good news is that you're already prepared to master recursion because you know all about functions, how to define them, and you've looked at self-reference already. So you know that you can refer to a function while you're defining it. Recursion is different because you can actually call a function while you're defining it. This sets off a chain of calls, which can turn out to express all kinds of interesting things. The examples in today's lecture are fairly straightforward. You could do them with a while loop if you wanted, but the examples that we'll touch on Friday are going to be considerably more involved. But you got to get the basics down first. That's what today's all about. And if you don't master recursion just by watching the video, well, that's totally normal. You have to practice, you have to solve some problems, and that's what discussion this week is for.